Hello everyone, welcome to today's lecture. I'm Maurice Ashley, as you probably have guessed by now. And we're going to go over a topic that I find quite fascinating. It's a topic of imbalance material. The positions themselves are really interesting, and we're just going to go over some fun games. And I like to explore the database to find those kind of choice nuggets of fun games, crazy positions, kind of wild, leading in death for one side. That's always nice. So we're going to go over that today, and I'm going to really challenge you to look and find moves. Those of you who are watching this on YouTube, make sure you pause when I ask questions and see if you can solve them yourself, because I like to have interactive lectures, not just boring, I'm going to tell you how smart I am lectures. So let's start with this position that I found that's really fascinating. Came from just a random game I found in the database between a 1600 and a 1700 player. So you think, like, what's there for us to look at? So this is a position with white to move. And it's clear that white has a simple-ish position. He's down a pawn that he must have sacrificed in the opening. It's white to move now after rook f8. White's down a pawn, sacrificed the pawn in the opening, and now has this position. And the question is, what would you play as white from this moment? And what move strikes your fancy? But it requires that you do look a little bit deeply into the position, because it's going to be much sharper than you think that this might lead to something. It's really fascinating position we have here. Any suggestions? Yes. Queen takes e6. Wow. That's fabuloso. That's just showing off. Sacrificing the queen in this position, I didn't consider that move. I kind of like it. For one thing, it looks like you have to take this thing, because f7 is hanging straight. All right, so we'll take. And knight takes e6. I like the idea of the sacrifice. The move itself I don't really care for, though. So I just like the fact that you decided you want to sacrifice and trap his queen. But there's an easy refutation to this, unfortunately. I mean, clearly his queen's trapped and it's not going anywhere anytime soon.
Bishop d5.
Bishop d5. I'm not sure what it does if I take it. You take with the knight. And what if I take your queen now? I'll take his bishop. What if I take your knight with check? Then I take your rook on c8, and this is not a happy person. It kind of didn't work out. A little bit. Yeah, bishop d5 is not a necessary move. Come on. You should be able to find this move. Yeah, you just move the king. Like, why did you sacrifice your piece? You're going to have to take my queen, and I'm just going to take you back with whatever I want. And that was the end of that. You sacrificed a piece for flash. It was flashy, but it didn't work. Flashy doesn't count unless it works. So queen takes e6 is not a great move.
Knight takes e6.
Knight takes e6 is attractive. Absolutely. Same thing. Not the same thing, but definitely the sacrifice is the starter. And after pawn takes, we've gotten our pawn back. We're a piece down now, so we're in. So what's the situation here?
Bishop takes e6.
Bishop takes e6 with check. So king moves. Okay, which knight do you want to take?
F6.
So bishop takes knight on f6 has been called. And now we play bishop takes. Sorry? Rook takes d7. This is actually the game. This is the game. This is the line. So now what? Black's queen is trapped. If you play rook takes e6, I just take your queen on d8 with check, then I take your rook. So that's not happy news. So what do we do here? You play queen takes rook, I play bishop takes.
Rook takes e2.
Rook takes, I play knight takes.
Then swap rooks on c1.
Yeah.
Yep. Much better there.
Much better?
Yeah.
I don't know about much better.
Harder.
I wouldn't call it much better. So you want to play, let's just go over that line. You want to play queen takes, bishop takes, you want to take here, knight takes, takes, takes. You're down a pawn currently, which you better hurry up and win back. And then you want me to, let's say, move my knight, and you're going to claim much better, or
okay,
probably better, two bishops in the passed pawn.
One, two bishops,
but much better is probably overstating it. So, rook takes knight. White was counting on this combination to take care of business until black played the very next move. Black played rook takes on c3. Oops, what happened here? Getting rid of the protector of the queen. That was the main point. After all that flash by white, black ends up with a boomerang at the end of it and hits him in the face. Now, you can't take the queen because this is slightly upsetting. Rook back. What's the next move?
Rook takes
e6, bat out. On the back end. Nasty. Beautiful, right?
Pretty frustrating for white.
Pretty frustrating for white. So white continued with queen d2 and, position's busted. And black said, more flash, and played bishop to g5. And bishop to g5, what do? Black's rolling all over you, and bishops are screaming. If only your rook were in pin, you could play queen d8 and checkmate him.
Yeah.
But your rook on d1 is pinned, so.
Yeah.
F4 is what he played. And black played rook takes rook and then moved the bishop back and had the two bishops in the rook. But, believe it or not, white is winning now. With what? With the queen. Queen takes c1. Overlooked by both players. And all of a sudden, white is winning because the bishop is overworked. You want to play queen d8? This is how you get your rook to d8, by unpinning your rook. White missed this line. Can you imagine? Look how beautiful this game was. And by the way, these are two not highly rated players, but some really spectacular tactics, right? So we started here. Knight takes on e6, pawn takes, queen, bishop takes e6 check. King moves, bishop takes knight in order to win the knight on d7. Bishop takes, unpinning. Rook takes, trying to win. Beautiful flash tactics, getting back his pawn. He's up a pawn right now, he's hitting the queen is trapped. Looks like he's forced to go into an endgame. Black counters with rook takes. Beautiful move. Rook takes c3. And you can't take on c3 with anything because of queen takes d7. I mean, this is spicy. Great chess. Because of the pin, obviously. So after rook takes on c3, he took the queen. Rook takes back. Bam! Another shot. Queen protects, And black should just trade now, but black decides to give the little extra flashy, and white misses queen. White played f4 here and misses the beautiful queen takes c1. Nasty, right? Tactics are just, chess is, doesn't matter if you're winning in chess, there's always tactics. There's always tactics. Winning or losing, there's always tactics. Keep looking for those tricks. They're hiding in plain sight. The game continued f4, rook d1, bishop back, and check. And he resigned because of the nasty mate that he was facing. Forced to throw his queen in the way, and the game was over. Not pretty. I mean, the game, the position itself was quite beautiful, but let's back up, because there was something really interesting for white that white overlooked. In this position, knight takes e6, fe6, white could play differently instead of playing this line that he played with bishop takes. He has a viable alternative that doesn't, at first, look like it makes any sense, or looks a bit scarier. But in fact, he could have easily played what move? Yes?
Rook takes d7.
Whoa, funky chess. Rook takes d7. Obviously, I can't play queen takes, because you've lined me up for bishop takes e6. But I could play knight takes. And that creates a little bit of a problem for you, because if you play bishop takes e6, I just move, and you have no pressure. And if you play queen takes e6, I do the same thing. I move, and you have no pressure. So I'm not thrilled by rook takes d7. A little bit too flashy. No, it's simple. The move, the sequence is actually simple. Queen takes e6 check. You must go in the corner, and now?
Bishop takes f6.
I got a nice little pin here, so your knight can't move. And after you take, just take on d7. Oh no, sorry. Sorry. No, that wasn't that simple. That last move was horrible. Queen takes d7 runs into this. Surprise, surprise. Back up a moment. Yeah, so always tricks, right? Obviously, I can't take rook takes rook because of queen takes queen. So no, in this position, this move, rook takes d7. Stopping all the tricks. And now white is up a pawn cold. After rook takes e6, I take with check. You take with whatever. I play bishop takes. And now it's black who's scrambling for some play, maybe with like rook d2 or something. But white's up a pawn right now. Yeah, I mean, rook d2 is useful. Probably a good idea, although I can probably play knight e4. No, I think black's going to win his pawn back because of pressure. Because we don't want to play knight d1 or knight d1. Actually, I can still take on b2. Rook b1 is the move I don't want to play, but maybe I might have to grovel for a little while, although you might play this move. I really don't like passive pieces. So it looks like he'll win his pawn back. But this is how white could have won his pawn clear, right? So if white doesn't want to be in this position, it's an interesting position. Like maybe knight e4? No, because the bishop takes knight, so because he can bring the rook back. So this position is looking fine for black. Black gets his play back. But white gets his pawn and just has to give the pawn up, probably in just like bishop b3, I would think. And just say, go ahead, take the b2 pawn, and then we'll just, you know, go about our business. So white could have gotten his material back this way, but he chose the flashy way and got spanked for it. All right, let's look at the next game. Sorry, let me save that analysis, and we'll look at the next game. All right, this position, I want to test you here. It looks, after this move, it looks as though, the last move was f3. It looks as though the position is very close to even-ish. Except, because white has more development, white is better developed than black, And the pawns are even. This bishop has no way to get into the game without, you know, bishop d7 might be the only move. White does have a weakness here and a weirdly fianchettoed queen, but it looks as though everything is fine. However, and actually it is fine, but white has to play perfectly from this moment to stay in the game after black's next move. So, can anyone tell me what you think black should do right now? C5, very good. C5 is a strong move. This knight has nowhere to go. The move F3 stole a square from it. And so knight E2 or C2, you're hanging this bishop, right? So you just can't block the protection from your queen. So the knight is limited. Where can the knight go? Except to B5, only move. And now, what would you play as black? Black is a very potent idea. Queen E3 check. I play King H1. Now you take the bishop. All right, I'll take that guy off. I don't know. What about Bishop H3? You say nothing. Rook to E1. Rook to E1. Slightly problematic. Huh?
Yeah, rook E1, queen F3. Oh, wait.
You could do that too, but I think queen E1 is slightly better. So, this looks strong. All right, so then queen E3 check, king H1 was a mistake. What is the correct move? Queen F2, aren't you hanging the bishop on B2?
Well, I think queen E3, rook E3, and rook D8.
Very well done, sir. Bishop B2, the queen is pinned, obviously, cannot take the bishop, but we have this trusty line, and all of a sudden, the lack of development for black gets mated. So, queen E3 check doesn't quite work because of the brilliant queen F2 with tricks, always tricks in chess. So, what should black do otherwise? Bishop H3, I take.
Yeah. Well, then queen down, check. Pick up the bishop on B2.
Hold on. I'm going to do this, and you're going to play this check?
Yeah.
And when I move, you're going to take this piece? And what do you do about knight C7 at the end?
Yeah, that is annoying.
Slightly annoying position. Why did you check me, though? What was the purpose of your check? Well, then it's not a good idea. There's no reason to check me at all.
Well, yeah, the queen back there guards C7.
Yeah, why don't you just, you know, like just take the piece. If you want to argue about having a decent position, then just take the piece. But are you feeling that black is much better here in any shape or form? Black's not saying much here, I would argue.
A tiny bit, but not enough.
Not enough to write home about. So, C5, knight B5. Michael Adams, Grandmaster Michael Adams, would do something in the middle of an attack that always impressed me. I think I mentioned this before. He would impress me by trading off pieces in the middle of the attack in order to strengthen the attack. And I always thought that was weird. Like, when you're attacking, you shouldn't trade. But this guy would trade. This guy trades often in the middle of an attack. And here, counterintuitively, the move bishop takes b2 is the best try. He's not going to win, but it's the best try. Simple trading of pieces. Queen takes, and now bishop here. Just simple chess. Now white, who has been playing well enough so far, only a couple of moves accurately, must play a precise move now to stay in the game. There's only one way to do it. And you better play right. Queen f2, you drop the exchange on f1. That's not acceptable. Rook e1 is what he did actually, which was he went down that route, which actually worked out for him in the long run, believe it or not. Miraculously. And I'm not sure you all are going to find the right move for Black when the time comes in that position. But right now, White must defend well. See, this is what chess is really all about, is these kind of concrete situations where you have to make decisions. Everybody's studying openings, what line should I play? That's not what chess is about. Chess is about a simple situation I put on the board in front of you and say, what do you do now? This could happen to you, what do you do now? And you have to make a decision through calculation. You could have prepared your whole opening, you could have gotten your good position, and now you say, okay, so now you got this position, what do you do now? Because the opening is not going to win for you. Knowing the opening is not going to win. It might not lose for you because you have a solid opening, but it's not going to win for you because you have some brilliant novelty that you prepared and you spend all these hours getting ready to drop on somebody and then they play a different line and you're in a different position. And now you have to think for yourself. So knight d6, and if he takes on f1, same deal. So this move takes and takes. And Black doesn't have anything to win the game with. Black's main problem is this bishop can't really kind of kamikaze itself because because we have a slight little threat of mate on the board, which Kramnik fell for. Does anybody remember Kramnik falling for this mate? All right, and against the computer, and he just fell for, not this one, it was on h7. But still, the knight on the back rank protecting a mate is not good. If a former world champ can fall for it, then we can fall for that one too. So knight d6 is the only move against this move. Instead though, White played rook e1. And now, let's follow this line. Takes, takes, takes check, king f2. Now, what do you do as White? I'm sorry, as Black, forgive me, as Black. As Black. Black now has to play well in order to win this position. So we have a vote for rook AE8. We have a view rook F1. Who thinks those look like the two natural moves? Of those two moves, who thinks rook AE8? You got a vote.
I'd rather play
rook AE8. Who thinks rook F1? You gotta vote. No, no, some people don't want to vote. They're still looking.
Well, actually, rook f1.
The move that is correct is absolutely rook f1, keeping the tempo of the attack. There's a problem with this move. Too slow, but only one move to show it. Only one move to save it, to save yourself. It's the move g4. And suddenly he's playing king g3. This was actually what happened in the game, and Black threw away the advantage immediately. So you have to be aggressive in these moments, right? It's not that you have to be aggressive. It's very important to understand what your opponent's next move is. What do they want more than anything else? Whenever you're attacking, and it goes for puzzle solving as well. One bad habit of players, and if you could overcome this, or if you could learn this, you'd become a much stronger player, is when a person puts a position in front of you and says White to move and win or Black to move and find the strongest move, usually people go, okay, so what move should I play? If the other person has a threat, like a concrete threat, they'll notice it and then they'll try to deal with it. But when the other person doesn't have a threat, very rarely do weaker players stop and go, okay, forget about the fact that I was just informed that it's my turn to move and win. Let me figure out what the other person would do on the next move if it was their turn. Like, what would they do? Let me get inside their head before I even look. Like, what more than anything do they want to do? So like in this position, clearly they want to take your rook. That's for starters, right? But one thing the king is worried about is whether or not I have enough air. Like, do I have breathing room? because it's starting to get restricted quite a bit. So the move g4, you might want to play rook e8. You know, it's a very natural, let me double rooks. But white wants to do something, and that's get heir to the king. And so you have to think about, well, what could he do? And g4 is just messes up your attack. So this move doesn't work because of g4. So we now study this line, check. King goes up the board. Okay. Now we get this with tempo. So he's not going this way. There's going to be a lot of pain going in this direction. Because the bishop f5 check, and then the rook comes down, swarm. So king here is forced. Now what? You got the king all the way up, you got two rooks and a bishop. Queen's offside, the knight's offside. This is a very natural attacking move, and it is h6. So g5 is threatening mate. That's a nasty little mate. King is frozen in space. What can it do? Looks nothing to do but play the move g4. You've got to free yourself. And now, king has only one move. We don't let him do it. Except your bishop is no longer stopping him from running to the f5 square. So that's a slight problem we have to deal with. But the main point is corral the king, corral the king, corral the king. White played queen f2. Sorry? Mate and three has been called. g5 check, king up. And now the attack is unstoppable. What do you want to do? Double rooks?
Yeah, I thought it was
double rooks. He can play queen back to b2. This f3 square is going to be a small problem for him after the rook comes down, and life is looking quite ugly. I think the game ended here. Yeah. So simple attack. The simple trades led to this, and white didn't play perfectly and ended up getting roasted, missing knight d6. One move could be the difference between winning and losing, as we know in chess. All right, so those are two interesting positions. I'd like to get to the next game. Let me just see. Oh, this one was a very funny game to watch, so I'm going to start off right in the middle of it. No, wasn't that it was so funny. It was just the inaccuracies played in the game. So I just want to ask you this question right here. You have black, right? What would you do here with the black pieces? What's your automatic instinct?
Rook takes,
right? Black decided to take with the queen. But rook takes looks very strong and looks like a lot of pressure. But how do you play? You play this takes with check, rook back, rook check, rook takes, and queen back. How do you play in this position? This is a strange position to me. How do you play and how do you evaluate the position? So instinctive evaluation here was after this sequence, let's go back, this sequence, black looked like he had an attack. Black plays rook takes f3, white rips this pawn off on a7, the rook drops back, a quick trade, queen back, and you said you like black because the attack fizzled out. However, in queen and rook endings, the most important things are 1, initiative, and 2, king safety. The most important things. Queen and rook endings are about initiative and king safety. And black can still maintain the initiative, but more importantly, white's king is never safe. White's king is always going to be in need of some kind of protection. So black's pawn structure may be slightly worse, but it ain't that much worse. And white's king is always an issue. But black does not have to force it. Black can just play moves. So the best move for black to keep the pressure on is queen b4. Just threaten something. It's not your problem that his king is weak. You're just going to keep the pressure on. Simplest move is what? B3? But you can see the issues that come up with B3. Queen to C3. And black has the initiative. Black is harassing white here. White could play something like rook to c1, and then black could play very positionally with b4. And black's pawn structure is much better than white's now, like light years better. These pawns are frozen forever. This king is never safe. Queen c6 check could happen when he feels like it. He's threatening, his queen is frozen because the rook could come down to f2. Rook f4 is possible in some position and just dominating the board. And I think you'll like black a lot more now when you see these kind of moves than you did a second ago. It's a positional game. It's not an attacking game. The attack fizzled, but it transformed itself into something much more powerful. And that is a positional bind. And this is just as useful. And so black is better. Black is the one who still remains better here. It was paradoxical because sometimes when the attack fizzles, you think, oh, the attack is dead. So what's the big deal? But if the guy can keep the positional features, dynamic features alive, and even the strategic one of the weak king, it doesn't matter if my attack is there. I'll just stay patient and beat you later. Make sense? Okay. The move I want to jump to is this position, this ending. Sorry, I actually want to show the story of this position. He traded, and now look at this game. He played rook f2. So what I mean by it is he traded this here and trade here. And I play rook f2. Now white should realize, wait a minute, I get a golden opportunity to play rook takes f3, rook takes, and king g2. And I'm out the corner, I'm back in the game, and everything's fine. It's like, if he plays rook e3, I'll just play the slightly embarrassing king here. Well, lucky for him, he has rook here. And I can chase him out, and white is back in the hunt. Instead, white decided for some strange reason to play rook fe1 and allow this thing. Rook c1, allow that thing. Rook attacks, here goes this guy. And suddenly, black has a rook on the seventh, and it's clear who's better here. So the game continues b3, king up, a4, take, take. Here comes the king. H3, here comes the king, and black's obviously much better. So white bailed, black took, went after the second guy. Give me that. Push, push, nope, going nowhere. Push, push, rook over. This is over. Push, check, and what's the right move here? Better question, what's the wrong move here?
King d2.
King d2. That's what we'll do in the game. Allowing the slightly embarrassing rook b2 check. Oh my God, what did you do? You had two connected passed pawns, and now you let the guy get a queen. Like, unbelievable mistake. Sad, but true, is what happened. Of course, any king move wins. Any other king move. Well, maybe not king e2, but any don't go to the rank, basically. Even king c2 actually would win. So now suddenly white has a queen on the board. But black still has strong play. White played queen a5 check, king to e3. And now queen g5, I like your instincts. Queen g5 is a very strong move. Sorry about that. Queen g5 is a very strong move, keeping the Prepet issues alive. But instead, white decided to play the move queen e5 check and faced the unfortunate, king to d3. And now all of a sudden, white has very few moves to check. Everything's controlled. B5 is controlled, F5 is controlled. So white could only play queen to g3 check, and now king to c2. White could only play queen c7 check, and now king to d1. It's like, uh-oh, what happened? Like, what happened? Suddenly he's busted. Queen's coming. He played this move and got mated. Poor guy. Chess is wicked. Okay, so that was that game. Crazy positions, right? Crazy blunders. All right, let's load the next one. Oh, so this position, I believe a few players have already seen. This is a fascinating position. White has played the move bishop to b6. Actually, I was working with you on this position before, right? Bishop to b6, attacking the black queen. The queen has only one move, and now the move knight to c5. You say crap. It always sucks when a guy just puts his knight on a great square, right? Just attack your queen. So what does black do right now? So black's queen is only one move, right? And we should look at that move, queen h3. Now, this could be slightly embarrassing for white. This knight is hanging, and this rook is hanging. You move your rook, I take your knight. You move your knight, I take your rook. Like, what's the deal? But white had foreseen this position and has a very strong move to play here. A pretty good move to play. Anyone?
Bishop f1.
Bishop f1. Who saw that move? I like that move. We didn't even talk about that move when we were analyzing. Wasn't it? Okay, so bishop f1 traps the queen. So beautiful idea by black, by white, excuse me. Unfortunately, black is winning. And I hate those positions where you make a guy do something and then he does it and you lose. Those always suck, right? So knight c5, black has no choice. Black has to take the knight. And now rook takes queen and black has to take the rook. And oh, black's gonna win a bishop. Game over. Black's gonna collect the collection plate. White literally forced black to beat him. Yeah, just take my piece. I'll get your queen. Oh, snap. My bishop's trapped. What happened? Game over. Too many pieces. All right? So that's not good when you force a guy to beat you. That's never good. All right. Odd position. So now let's take a look at this one. And it's this position with Lawrence Trent with the black pieces, who's going to be my commentator on the Millionaire Chess Open. Actually, I'd like to show you the opening, because the opening is a bit surprising. Those of you who know the dragon may like this theory. So it's a Sicilian, and the game goes to this position, and black plays a dragon. And then white plays the queen d2 variation without playing bishop c4. He castles. And this line with d5, king b1. And black's recipe is knight takes knight. The trick to king b1, by the way, is if black plays pawn takes pawn, he runs into knight takes knight. And queen d2 is not check. And if you take the knight, you're going to lose your queen. So if you play queen d2 first, then knight takes e7, you just lost this knight here, and now the queen here, and you just drop the piece for no reason. So that's the trick behind king b1 again in this line. So king b1, and black plays knight takes. Black could also play e5, I believe, but it doesn't work well in the king b1 line. So knight takes knight, and now white plays this move, e5. Down a piece and plays this move, e5. Very sharp line. A very tricky idea. White's going to win the piece back plus the d5 pawn. Everything is okay. Except black has this crazy idea. Knight f5, takes, takes, knight takes, feeling pretty good. Red threatening knight f6 check. Queen takes.
Oh, wow. Holy crap.
Oh, wow. Holy crap. I like that response.
Not
your next move, right? Queen takes queen. Give me that guy. Queen back. Give me that. And black is down a queen for a rook and bishop. But supposes that these two bishops are very strong pieces, and white will not be able to fight against this piece. So this is a critical thing, that this bishop is on the board, because white can maybe fight the other bishop, but can never fight this one. And white's queen doesn't have any weaknesses to attack. So black will just generate energy in this position and hopefully do something.
So white should be slightly worse?
I think white's just fine, but white has to play accurately. I think white is fine. It's a bishop and a rook. It's a queen. I'm not losing. They're monsters, the two bishops. They're not total monsters, unfortunately. Bishop d3, queen e2, bishop e4, and c3, which I think was not particularly well played. I don't think he has to bring his bishop off of this square, particularly. And I think white's fine after rook d1. This is not a necessary. You can play rook d1 with the idea of playing c3. And bishop c2, and the game is not going to go anywhere bad for him. What I mean to say is this move. He's just threatening to do this and bring his bishop back to c2. And he should be fine. Instead, he played this move, gave the guy the file, played this move, gave the guy the seventh rank, and his queen is now in the back row. I mean, seriously? So that's your... But he's threatening on b7. So now black played b5. No, sorry. Black played rook d6. Daring him to take on b7. Daring him to take on b7. Because, of course, that move would be slightly unpleasant to have to face.
Did he take on b7?
He did not take on b7.
I was like, wow.
He decided to just play rook g1 to free his queen to be able to move. And now, black missed a really spectacular win that simply comes out of the blue. Like straight out of the blue. All right, let's go to the line. Bishop takes c3. Pawn takes. Rook check. Obviously, I cannot go in the corner because I get a nasty little mate landing in my face. So I have to go after rook b6 check. Sorry, after rook b6 check, I have to go here. And you want to take on a2, you said?
Yeah.
So, I can play bishop to b1, which is not the best move, but I'll play it.
I'll play rook a1.
You play rook a1. And now, I have a problem here, but maybe I can solve it like this. Yeah, my bishop is pinned. Well, not after that. Bishop a2, if I take, you take, and then you check and you win. That I'll believe.
That's a good move.
That's a good move. I take, you take, I take, and then you drop this move on me, and then you go up. This is a winning endgame for sure. However, unfortunately for you, I have this move. Now what? Your problem is, your follow-up, check, can be answered by king d2. Or actually, probably just king here is fine.
And if I take your rook, then...
And if you take my rook, I play check, check,
okay.
And borrow your rook. Slight problem. This will all look very natural. So it turns out you have to just do perpetual check, otherwise you lose the game.
I have to take on a2.
So correct in this position is counterintuitive after the bishop c3 sacrifice, and this happens a lot in chess, but when it happens, you know, like right at the moment, we miss it. Because usually when you sacrifice with boom, you're supposed to play check, boom, followed by capture, boom, and the attack rolls. You're not supposed to just quietly play rook takes a2.
That's what I just thought.
Like, I'm just going to relax. You figure out what I'm coming with next. So the problem here is that there's no queen d3 for white. White is, the threat is rook b6 check and then rook a1. But white can't play queen to d3 now because of rook takes queen. And that was the reason why the rook just has to sit there. And white has no moves. This threat is too nasty.
C4.
Block the bishop. Great move. Great move. What do you do here? Now rook B6 is unplayable. Because that rook's hanging. It's like, oops, we sacked a bishop and the guy's fighting. What's going on? Dude, you sacked a bishop. Now you're, what?
Rook
6 where? D2. It's possible. After queen c1, let's just play a random move. Now you have actually no way of improving your position.
D7.
That's slightly frustrating. Problematic. That's the threat, in case. And also, queen c3 is threatened as well. And he just organized his position quickly. So, the bishop sack, why black missed all this is because it's extremely complicated. He had to see the bishop sack, he had to play a quiet move, and then he had to deal with this c4 move, which completely disrupts the coordination of his forces. Except, all you have to do is play a simple move that re-coordinates your pieces. Rook d2, looking like the strongest one, is not it. There's another one that's much better.
D rook
to a6, coordinate a different way. Castle, yeah, right. Yeah, it would be nice to castle with white. And suddenly, this rook check is nasty. And the big difference here is queen d3 is playable, right? Same tricks. Shouldn't it be the same trick happening down here? Huh? Check. What do you mean, king here? The problem is the other rook is in the game.
Oh.
So please donate your queen to the cause. No tricks. We're not going to give you that old trick of queen d8, queen back. We're just going to borrow your queen and take care of it for the future. After you step your king up into paint. Very deep line. Bishop takes c3, and it might have felt like a quick sacrifice. Black missed this move. Black is a good player, like I said, but this is a very deep, this sequence of taking on a2 first, and also playing the move rook to a6 instead, that stuff is rich. By the way, I should say, this is my commentator, Lawrence Trent. This was in 2000 when he was a lowly 2188. He's now an international master, and I'm sure he would have found that sequence today. He better find it at the Millionaire Chess Open, I can tell you that. So, rich positions. These kind of positions are very difficult to play because of imbalanced material that happens. And I find that's one of the hardest positions in chess to deal with. I find these positions by doing a search in the database where I ask the database to find positions where they're queens versus other pieces. Give white a queen, give black rooks or rook and bishop combination, where black is winning. And you can do this kind of research yourself. And I would advise you to, because you get some extremely rich positions that a lot of people don't study. They study very common positions.